Hello and welcome to another edition of Hashtag Comedy TV, the comedy show that takes a serious look at the news around us. My name's Mr. C and I'll be your host for the next hour or so. However, we also have on the show our regular panel of the dark destroyer of comedy, Kane Brown, the Cockney Prince, Quincy, and the People's Champion, Slim. How you doing, guys?
What's going on, mate? Yeah, you all right?
Good? Not too bad.
Are you always having a look?
Come on. Anyway, listen, here's what's coming up on the rest of the show. We kick off with some entertaining videos. We then welcome Madeline Kelly and Jimmy from the Sky TV series In the Long Run. After that, Dane Baptiste and Josh Harry will be joining us to talk about anti-Semitism and those wily tweets. So this is your platform here at Hashtag Comedy TV, and we really do appreciate your support. Now, if you want to get involved with the comments, subscribe, like, and share. Right, now that's the housekeeping done. On with the show. And here's a little reminder of just how serious this COVID is. She slapped the living. She slapped the disease out of his soul.
He couldn't help it, man.
That was Quincy
in the hospital just after operation.
I was just.
But you know what? That's typical of man, though, isn't it? You know that you could be on your sick bed or your death bed, you know, and if you see a little bit of bottom, boy, you're like, well, listen, before me go and see either the lard or see it, let me touch it one last time.
He was just testing his reflexes. That's what he was doing, testing his reflexes.
Yeah. And her reflexes were very good.
Yeah, they were much quicker.
Yeah. Trust me, man. Slim, what have you got for us?
Bro, listen, take a look at this clip and tell me if it don't mind you off school days.
First thing that you want to do is remember your rules when it comes to PEMDAS, okay? That's parentheses, exponents, multiplication, division, addition, and subtraction. Well, in this case, we can't solve the parentheses because we don't know what x is. So instead, we're going to start with distributing. Let's distribute the exponents first. We're going to make it 4x plus 12 plus 9. Minus 5 equals 32. Let's continue with PEMDAS. We're going to add the 12 and the 9, okay? 4x plus 21 minus 5 equals 32. Let's continue with the PEMDAS. We're going to do 4x plus 21 minus 5.
Well, let me tell you this. I wouldn't learn nothing. I wouldn't pass one exam with her as my teacher, not one. Yeah, I heard PDS 32, and what else is it's about three things in the whole of that little clip that I heard. You can't have teachers like that, body defined like that. So nah, man, you need matrons need to teach maths. You can't have this is nonsense. Are you looking at the board or are you looking at the bottom as a 13, 14-year-old boy? What are you looking at? What do you think?
Listen, man, if she was my teacher, I know that I'm learning maths and human anatomy at the same time, bruv. Trust me. Well, PEMDAS, that means P equals into this man.
I'll tell you something. She was so fit, she turned my missus.
I'm Slim. I never heard nothing that she said. You know what I mean? But I don't believe that's real. That must be. There's no way she's a teacher. There's no way. Everyone.
You know what we need? We need somebody that's a math genius that watches this to tell us, is that true mathematics or is she just fooling us? Because as you say, like come on now, we don't know.
Remember that woman that did the sign language that time and she did sign language? Yeah, you remember that? This woman's a pro. Anyway, she's a gym. She ain't no maths teacher.
And the man standing next to Nelson Mandela.
Yes.
You remember that black man they got in South Africa and he was doing the speech and they said they don't understand what he's saying.
But you know what, though? Teachers are known to double up on their jobs, isn't it? Because, you know, back in the day, there was a maths teacher. She's a maths teacher and a PE teacher. So she's just, like, after that lesson, she's got a leotard under that. That's just unbelievable.
Hold on. But be honest, though. If she was your teacher, If she was your tutor, yeah, you know that you're not missing one of her lessons. You're gonna turn up with your pencil,
yeah, but you're not learning
your ruler,
nothing.
And your baby oil.
Yeah, you're not learning nothing.
Your attendance 100% and your exam marks are F.
I don't know about exams, mate, but I'm busting all of my exams if she's my teacher. I'm telling you that from now.
And the F ain't fail.
anyway, listen, you lot shouldn't be sexualizing teachers anyway. But do you remember how excited you lot used to get if you found like wildlife in your garden? Yeah, remember years ago when you were little? Yeah? Have a look at this.
She tread pun Kermit, man. No, man. No.
Hey, frog legs to that, brother. That's...
It's just like chicken.
That's a child. That's a child.
You know what's funny?
She slipped on it. You know what I mean?
I remember my twins. My twins, when they were like, I think they were three. And for some reason, like, we decided to get them a guinea pig, innit? You know, pets don't last long in a black household anyway. Goldfish get overfeed or don't get feed and dead and just floating on the water. So we've got the guinea pig now. One day, I come downstairs and I heard them. So I come downstairs. Brother, when I look, I see blood on the wall, blood on the floor.
Carnage.
It looked like a proper crime scene. I said, what the? Brother, I look around. I said, what? Who dead in here? What? Why them guys? Brother, they didn't realize when they're free, they don't understand about life and death, innit. They were playing catch with the guinea pig. They were playing catch. And when, even when the guinea pig was dead, they were still. When I spray up the whole living room. If you don't know that now, guaranteed. This was 17 years ago. There's DNA from that guinea pig still in there right now.
Question is, of all the animals, and you know what guinea pigs are associated with, why are you getting a guinea pig?
I don't know. You think it was my idea? You think I was bringing rat into my house? Yeah. That's not my idea.
Yeah, you're done, rat for real.
Yeah, it's a rat. But I felt sorry for it because I'm an animal lover, innit? I love animals, but I wouldn't keep them because I know they're a lot of responsibility. But I would. I've got a 3-year old boy now. Even now, you see him, they don't understand. You see him outside, and if he sees something like an ant or something, he's just trying to step on everything. I said, you can't do that. They don't understand. No child should have a pet, especially black children. Don't get no black children, no child until they're probably 15. That's it.
Back in the day, our parents weren't having it, mate. Trust me.
Step up from housefly. Look after the housefly.
Yeah.
All right, look, talking about the frog, man. Look, it's something I want to show you guys, right? So if you want to take advice from a rich bitch, check this out.
Like a rich bitch, part one. Cartier bracelet is a must. Rolex is a must. Fucking bag. You have not completed your cunting journey if you do not have one. If you're a real big cunt, you have to have a fur coat. You not only don't give a fuck about the animals, you don't give a fuck about the people either. And last but not least, you must drive SUV. G-Wagon or Range Rover only. If you don't have one of these things, your rich bitch journey is not complete.
Do you know what, right? You know, we were talking about this previously. Delivery is so important. Look how sexy she made the word bitch, Sam. Now make Nas say the word bitch. It's a complete different terminology.
She said it in a ring on her tongue, man. I like how you said that. You know what I mean? Kinsey is so kinky. You understand? The word bitch, you know. Do you see how sexy she said it?
But the thing was, you know what's funny? She's, you could see she is about her money. She herself.
Yeah, of course.
She don't play around. She's direct. She's attractive. She ain't messing around. She'd get money out of me, even though I know she's still trying to scam me. She still get money
out of me.
You know, Kane, remember that time we went to that restaurant? Kane, remember that time we went to that restaurant and there was those Russian girls who were there? She reminded me of the Russian girl who was there.
Yes.
Because she was like saying to Kane, I can tell where you come from. I know you're Nigerian. I look at you and can see you're Nigerian. And she was just like... She was just completely full of herself, mate.
Yeah, the woman, but she was too confident. She was drunk, but she was... Her confidence level was ridiculous. She threw me.
Listen.
Even me and C were sitting there like, I want to flirt. Who's this girl talking to? But the girl had us intrigued. She had us intrigued.
She knew.
Because her confidence level was like, she come from something. Like, who is she?
Yeah.
Who is she?
She was literally looking down on us.
But she wasn't though. She wasn't. She was like the alpha male. What she was doing was reverse psychology. Yeah. So what she was doing, she was endearing herself to us by trying to put us down and then trying to make us like be friendly with her. It was weird. The whole thing was just weird.
Do you know what I like about that, Kane, what you just mentioned? Right? You've taken all that in, now the event has passed. At moment, you would see her like this.
At the time, she got my bank statement. She got my PIN number. I don't know how.
Listen, I don't know about Kane. I was just frightened because I thought the next thing she was going to kidnap us and sex traffic us in some flipping foreign country or whatever. She was scary. We were this close to being taken. Trust me, bro. You know
no
what I mean?
One was sex trafficking you, brother. Trust me. Don't worry about that.
Anyway, listen.
They were telling you about. They're like, "Why you bring this for? Why you bring this? You don't need this one."
All right. Listen. Anyway, oh, let's move on. Let's move on. Shut up, man. Listen, it's time for our first guest. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Madeline, Kelly, and Jimmy.
Hey.
Hello, guys. Hey. How you doing? Thank you for joining us on the show. I just want to say congratulations on the third series of In the Long Run. For those of you who haven't seen it, have a look at this.
Dear son, I am worried about your little brother Valentine, so I am sending him to live with you.
Hey! Cannot believe I'm here at last!
If you're going to live here, there's going to be some rules.
How is this somewhere?
What fine English weather we are having.
Have you done something wrong?
I'm going to make my mark here. Be some money.
Valentine's in the house!
Oh, I love London. Good evening, sir.
It's a great show. Absolutely great show. Now, for all of the viewers who haven't seen it yet, I totally, totally recommend it. I just want to have a first question, first of all, to Madeline. In the long run, is the brainchild of Idris. Now, what is it like being next to Idris, working alongside him? Come on, tell the truth now. What's going through your mind?
The truth is, what's going through your mind? Beautiful, brilliant, and funny, and just that kind of dreams come true. Like I've dreamed when I watched his stuff early days, and just was like, what an actor! I hope one day I can be in the same arena as him, and then to be working alongside him. We mustn't play about praying. Praying is real because I was like, wait. And every now and again, you know, I'll tell people what I'm doing, and it's the response. What? And I'm like, you know what? This is a big deal. Let me just enjoy my life a bit here. And he's brilliant. And yeah, I think it's just been amazing.
So I want to ask you. So do you because you're married to him, your character, yeah? Agnes is married to him. So do you still wear the ring?
Well, I'm married in real life, so I have my own ring. But
same.
But Amanda got me.
No
my
pressure
own
for your husband.
No pressure at all. No, but I have my own brilliant, set of rings for the show, and I have my own rings in real life.
Okay.
Kelly, just a question for you quickly. So the show's set in 1985, yeah? Now, did the show remind you of that time when you were growing up? Like, you know, all the things around you, like maybe the cars and stuff like that, and the TVs and the food and the kitchen?
Yeah, totally. I mean, I was born in the 80s and, I, you know, looking at back at photos and, I remember it being a quite a vibrant time with all of the clothes, the shell seats, the perms. It was like a really visual time, wasn't it? And, you know, I think the show really reflects that. Like, it's fun. And some of the stuff that we wear is gone.
Yes. Yep. No, go on. I was saying I had a perm one time as well, you know that. Well, go on, isn't it? For some reason, I don't know why.
I remember Jimmy's perm back in the day, mate.
Jimmy,
yeah, Valentine looks great, you know. But yeah, I think it really reflects the 80s, you know, really well. And it's good that it does, because, you know, when you watch a show and then something takes you out of it, if the detail's not right, and you go,
hang on
a minute. No, that would not have been there. And I think they've been really clever with
iPhone 10.
So I think it's they've done well. They've done well to make it really authentic with its look and feel. Good. And the music, oh my God, the music's, you know, very, you know, bang on.
Yes, excellent. Jimmy, we're going to ask you a question. Please tell us a little bit about your character, Valentine. Tell us a little bit about that character.
Okay, so I'm playing Valentine, who is Look at that perm. I'm playing God, you got to take that. I can't even answer this question. Look at that. that's me getting caught in my bedroom when I was young. So Valentine basically is Idris's uncle. So it's his dad's younger brother. And I play Valentine, and he arrives into the family's lives from Sierra Leone and sort of turns all their lives upside down. And he's like a breath of fresh air, you know? But also you can laugh with him and stuff like that, but he's determined. He's trying to make something of himself in a new country. And there's a little bit of naivety there, but it's quite nice to go on that journey with him as he's trying to sort of, I suppose, find his place. And I've not got to meet Idris's uncle yet, but we've got like this Bible, guys, which is about that big of legendary stories about how amazing his uncle is and how he can sort of, there's a dry party where like only two people are dancing. Give him 5 minutes, he'll have like 130 people in there and the party is vibing. And so it was really good to have that information to work from, but also he just gave me creative license to do my own thing. So uncle, if you're watching, I'm sorry if I'm doing something that you don't like or is not acting, but it's nice to have some creative license to bring different elements to it. And, you know, for me, guys, you know, watching you guys, you're all kings to me. So, like, you know, to be able to do a comedy with Idris and set in the 80s and to basically do something that's not been done before. This show's iconic, do you know what I mean? It's a story about a black family in the UK that happens to be from Sierra Leone, West African. You know, we've all grown up watching the Desmonds or the Trotters in Only Fools and Horses or, you know, shows like The Office. But this, for me, is a legendary show and it's for everybody, you know? It's a universal show and I'm glad people seem to be enjoying it.
Yeah, brilliant. Now listen, everybody likes a Charlie Man show.
Say it again?
Sorry, Slim, what was that you said?
I said everybody loves those shows work because we love to watch the trying man, the man that is on hope. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? All those shows that you mentioned and your show, people enjoy. You came from Sierra Leone and now they want to see you succeed. You got that character. Yeah, man.
No, thank you, man. Thank you. And we're hoping that it's going to go for like 10 seasons so we can go up to the 90s. 2000, you know what I mean? then he just can play himself as a kid.
It's true, isn't it?
Talking about kids, our own kids, Quincy's in the show. So Quincy, tell us how that came about and tell us a little bit about your character, Frank, please.
All right, Eric came back. It's kind of weird. So I got a phone call at the first season to basically add little jokey jokes to it, and because I'm a family friends, and that they said wanted to know how true it was to the story, and I had to remind them. I was like, you do know that I'm from the Caribbean, right? So that some of the material to translate. But cut a long story short, to play the role as Frank, I do a little bit on the set. There was no drama school, there was no preps. I know Idris, innit? He goes, could you do the part? It's like, all right. Yeah, I mean, so it was, I would say, one of my life-changing moments. Frank as a character was split originally of three characters, but he ended up being, obviously, he owns a pub, and he is like the main person within the area, and everybody coincides the pub, and it suits me right down to the ground as a pub owner and the focal point of the manor. Yeah, and I like the word Frank.
Sorry to cut you, right?
Yeah, I like the word Frank. Yeah, go on.
Where's your character from? Because I watched it.
He's Jamaican, Bajan, Cockney.
Yeah, he's Jamaican.
proper confusion, you know, mate. Yeah,
I'm gonna give you a joke. There's a couple of times, yeah. All right, okay. There's a couple of times, yeah, that I had lines because originally he's a Jamaican guy,
yeah,
right?
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
And I had lines, but the Jamaican I've grown up with has been Jamaican from Sand Clash Sound System yeah. days. So, yeah. You know what I mean? So like, I'm speaking like freaking Beanie Man, you know, right? You know what I mean? Or Bounty Killer, and not really. And then some of the staff members, the cast members, have said to me, like, lower, ease back the accent. Yeah, yeah. So I would talk right. Like I was in a Sound Clash.
Yeah, so, you have to take 20% off.
Give us a line then, Chris. Give us an example.
There was one time, Jimmy, I don't know if you remember, right? Do you know the scene where the first season, where the party is? Yeah, the party,
yes.
and he rams out my pub. My pub's not doing well, and he rams out my pub. He has his first DJ gig at the pub. So Jimmy told me to look. He had the lines, and he says, "Just Quincy, ad lib. You're a comedian. Ad lib. Just say how you feel." And I said, "Yeah, man. Yeah, go on, good man. I like the one with the prob." Yeah. I didn't realize that when you ad lib, you've got people who rewrite the script. So they're like, I had people come up to me, said to me, like the way you got. Like, oh, yes. Yeah, yeah. How'd you spell go on? GW. I don't know. Yeah, so the Jamaican accent was a toss up and a mix up of friends and old school sounds.
Yeah. So, Madeline, hello. So, how important was it for you to kind of help tell the story of, you know, a family traveling from an African country coming to England, like for you to try and represent that character?
That's a great question. It's really important. And firstly, an honor to be playing Idris Elba's mum, Auntie Eve. That for me, I was very, very touched that I could do that. And then coming from a family who migrated as well in the 70s, I really wanted to pay homage to that experience of being a child of the 80s, growing up in a community pretty much like the East Bridge Estate. There was that honor there that I wanted to portray, because there is this perception of, if you come from a certain part of London, you come from deprivation and everyone's walking around with gloom and doom. And actually, even though times were hard in the 80s, but as a community, there was a lot of love and respect and connections. Yeah. And my mom worked so hard, my dad worked so hard. Mm. And that generation of people that came over, they didn't come here to chill. They came to make a better life for themselves and family back home. So there was a real honor and pride in that. And I remember in the first meetings with Amanda Monk, who did our costume, and talking about like the costumes that we would wear and the perception of hair and things, and being so clear at, doesn't matter. If you only had one pair of shoes, those were shoes from Russell and Bromley.
Yes,
that were polished and kept cool. Right. Do you know what I mean? Like, right. We didn't mess about. We looked good, we smelled good, our children looked good, our children smelled good, our hair was on point. We took pride in all the things that we could take control of. Yeah. And it was just so, it was so refreshing to have that that dialogue. So Amanda would get really, like, our costume. You see how, like, the coats, you know, the quality coats that, if our parents still had them, they'd still be in the wardrobe because they were quality.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah. And the language.
Was hanging in the side.
No, yeah. You know the smell. You know. And my mom's got a different shoe size to me, so I couldn't wear any of her shoes. So, but you know, that kind of having that creative integrity was really important. And then being able to be on set and go, you know, my mom and her sisters, whenever they get pissed, they just switch into a tree. Or they'll just cuss you in another language, or they'll just, even in the presence of someone who doesn't speak the language, they'll just throw in something, and you're like, "Mommy, cut." Do you know what I mean? So having that creative freedom as well throughout the process was awesome, and knowing that when people watch it, they might be able to identify with that, and having feedback. There's a scene in episode one where we sat in, me and Agnes and Valentine sat in the car and talking about how hard it is coming to this country, the racism and just the perseverance that is needed. And a lot of people would kind of were touched by that and said, you know, I remember that, I remember this and I remember that, and yet they still managed to raise us to come and do what we're doing. And I had a big honor to be part of that storytelling.
Amazing.
Thank you for sharing that with us, man. Now look, when I've watched it, one of the characters that I'm really drawn to, Kelly, is your character, Kirsty. I mean, you're married number one to the legendary comedian Bill Bailey. You know, talk us through your relationship with Bill and what it's like for you playing your character, Kelly.
Look at Bill in that jumper. I mean, he looks so cute, even with a fag hanging out of his mouth. Look at him. I mean,
how could you not be in love with him?
How could I not? I really genuinely love Bill. He's such a nice bloke, and he's just so funny and natural, and totally great human being. So our relationship, so you know, it's like when you, I don't know you, but when you've been with somebody for a long time and the sex life kind of dries up a little bit, shall we say.
Oh, I know that story very well. Very, very well. I know that part too well, Kelly.
It's a universal thing, isn't it? And so so basically throughout the series that's kind of explored. Kirsty has a moment of madness and she goes off and she's with a black man and she gets pregnant and
You have the mixed race child.
You've got the mix. Yes. And then played by the brilliant Curtis Walker, and so basically, I've got two amazing men that I've been, you know, with, and then his character Leon doesn't really know about it, and. Bill's character Bagpipes ends up bringing up the child, as his own, and so that's been really interesting to play, and it's taken from a real story that one of the writers came up with, Grace, and I've got to remember who it was. It was like a famous.
It was a singer, a girl,
Yeah, who was it again, Mads? Took the story from?
Singer in M People.
A UK singer?
Yeah, a singer in M People.
Heather Small.
No, it wasn't Heather Small. It was one of her band members.
It was one of her band. Yeah, I'm going to have to Google it and find out. But yeah, so he
really
was brought
chatting
up.
People business today.
It's good because it has real, you know, authenticity about it. These are things that. That haven't really been explored before on TV, and you know, about heritage, about people who are brought up in white families, who are black, who are mixed race, I think it's really brave of him and really exciting. So that's one of the things that I've loved learning about, as a white actress, it's great.
That's a different kind of entanglement, isn't it?
That's a whole this time kind of entanglement. A bit of black, a bit of white. Best of both worlds you got going on there, girl.
So just bringing it back anyway to Bill. He's just the best second husband I could really wish for. I'm a lucky girl, and I've just loved every second of it. Bring it on.
Amazing. Yes.
Brilliant. Jimmy, sorry. Now, you, as young as you look, you've been around for a little while acting now. You've always been in work in either TV or in theatres. You've done comedy roles, you've done serious roles. I'd like to ask you, what is your preference? What do you prefer? The comedy or serious, theatre or TV? And has the industry changed for black actors over the years you've been in it for the better, or is there more needing to be done?
First of all, thank you, because I'm only 22, you know what I mean? So, I have no idea what it was like in the 80s. I'm watching loads of old school documentaries to understand the 80s. I have no idea what it was like. But you're right, it's been a joy in my career to be able to play, do comedy characters as well as dramatic characters. And I feel like I don't describe myself as just a comedy actor or just a dramatic actor. I'm an actor that I feel like I can do both. And for me, it's a hard one to say what I prefer. I feel like my end goal would love to be in film, I feel within film, you might get the mixture of, if you've got a decent budget, like time to rehearse, and it's sort of always out there, you can create iconic content. But I love, there's something about comedy that growing up, watching you guys, like every one of you, and as well as the posse crew, the real McCoys, the list goes on, and going to the Hackney Empire. Just, I think when people say, what's your education growing up in terms of, did you come from an acting family? I'm like, no, but I was an usher at Theatre Royal Stratford East. You know what I mean? I used to go to see shows at Hackney Empire. I used to love the 291 Club. Right at the time when it was out, because I'm too young to know about that. But
pull yourself out.
But there is something, I can feel it and hear the comic beats. Do you know what I mean? There's something naturally, I can lean into it. And I remember growing up watching your Desmonds and, Eddie Murphy's and your Richard Pryor's and your Steve Martin's and John Candy. And so comedy, it is hard for me, but it comes a bit naturally for me, And so it's hard for me to say I prefer comedy. And with the drama, for me, when I started doing that, suddenly I realized it made me feel like more of an actor, And yet, actually, I think it's actually harder to do the comedy. If you look at people like Robin Williams and stuff like that, the performances that they've done over the years, you can really see that some of the best actors, even Jim Carrey, do come from comedy. And so I don't know, I don't really have an answer, but theatre, in terms of performing it, I think theatre is my number one love, just in terms of you can't mess up, you can't retake. You've got 400 people or 600-700 people watching you. If you trip up, you can't go, can we go back? You got to keep going. Those moments when you can hear a pin drop when people are listening to you. So I don't know. I don't think I'm answering the question. I love it all. In terms of actors and, that whole thing, sometimes I go, why do I have to label myself as a black actor? But I get where we're going with the conversation. It's slowly turning, It's slowly turning, but not fast enough. I think there's still a lack of representation on screen. It is improving, but when I say on screen, I'm talking about sort of lead roles or significant roles where they are part of the central storytelling, you know? And it's even harder, I think, actresses, black actresses, you know, as well as Asian, even, you know, all ethnically diverse creatives, it's really, it's not good enough at the moment. And it's even worse behind the camera. But it is slowly turning. And I think we should be in a position now where we shouldn't have to have these stories, you know? And I think that's about the gatekeepers, the people, if they've got to commission the type of work that can enable people like, you know, Mads and Kelly to be in a film together or a TV show together. And it's not about because Kelly's white and Mads is black. You know what I mean? It's not about that. It's just that these are two friends that are setting up a business as lawyers. And we're just going to watch that. And I think there's a lot of re-education that needs to be done with our industry because we're about 10, 15 years behind the US. And yes, it's a bigger country, but the numbers don't lie, guys. You know, if you take Michaela Cole out of the equation, I say, name me five leading black actresses that are on TV at the moment, and then five men. You know what I mean? You'd be stuck. We are heading in the right direction. And we have to be hopeful and optimistic because look at us. I'm a lead in a show created by Idris Elba alongside Mads, Jeremy and Kelly, Bill Bailey. You know, this is season three. So this is before this moment where, this important moment where we're at, where a lot of honest conversations are having, even though we've been having them since the 70s and the 60s. You know, if you talk to Rudolph Walker and Norman Beaton, God rest his soul.
Come on.
But we are in our third season. So it needs to be celebrated. I want everybody to watch it, but especially I want our community to watch it because I do believe in representation and being that 10-year-old version of myself, seeing like stories and people that I can relate to that look like me is very important. And I hope that it doesn't just get stuck to being the only show. Like just because you've got In the Long Run doesn't mean you can't come with another show about some guy from Sierra Leone that was born here or you can't come with another comedy that might focus on a different black family. And I think that's the re-education of our industry. Sometimes you get the Luther, and it's like, we don't need other detectives. It's like, but he's got no friends that look like me. He's on his own. It's amazing. Amazing show.
Help him.
You know what's funny? Singing sad love songs.
You know where I watched In the Long Run? I was on a flight going somewhere. I was on a flight. And I watched it on the plane because I knew Quincy was in it. And I said, hold on, In the Long Run. It's so weird. I'm watching Quincy on the... I said, it was nice to see it. It was nice to see it, just to see...
Thank you.
Yeah, because you don't get those kind of films on a plane at all. Well, so for me...
Look at that.
It was wicked. It's amazing. Yeah. It's amazing.
Fantastic, man. Fantastic. Now, listen, it's been wonderful having all of you guys on the show, but we've got so much we've got to cover today. We want to wish you all the best with the new series. Madeline, Kelly and Jimmy, ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a round of applause. Yay!
Thank you guys for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming on.
Love you guys. Fantastic. Okay, moving on. Now, look, I don't know if any of you caught the tweets from grime artist Wiley or the massive backlash that followed, but here to help us discuss this are comedians Dame Baptiste and Josh Howie. Welcome them, please.
Yo!
Thank
right,
you.
Let's go day. Straight in.
What happened?
How are you all doing? You good?
Small day.
Yeah.
He's in serious mode already.
No, I'm all
Mike
good, man.
We got Mike Buffer here.
No, I'm good, man. I'm good.
Josh, how you doing, sir? Welcome.
Yes, thank you. It's an honour to be invited as the sort of historian of grime.
It's our pleasure having you here, bruv. Our pleasure having you here, man. Listen, let's get straight in and see one of the tweets, what happened this week. So as we can see, this is from Wiley from his Twitter account. He's saying, in fact, there are two sets of people who nobody has really wanted to challenge, hashtag Jewish and hashtag KKK. But being in business for over 20 years, you start to understand why. Has Wiley got a point? Quincy.
All right, Dane, let me just put it out there to you. Judging by the tweets, do you think that Wiley's got an issue with the Jewish community or his management?
I think it sounds like
he has a problem with two people in particular in the indigenous community. I think if you've paid attention to his previous comments about Drake, that seems to be the Jewish person he has the main problem with. And yeah, his manager John Wolfe, who in his interview with Sky News, he revealed has his MBE. So I don't necessarily think that Wiley has a problem, but then that being said, to look at his tweets is very hard for me to be like, oh, well, he's only talking about two people in particular, because he does go on to make a series of very anti-Semitic remarks. And even likening the Jewish community to the KKK is would seem like a real stark generalization and be massively inaccurate. So even though on further, I guess, inquiry, it seems that Wiley doesn't have a problem with the Jewish community. And I don't know how he can, because the guy supports Tottenham Hotspur. So for me, it's like, it's almost... as in, like, you know, for you to like support a team like that so staunchly and then not be aware of their legacy in terms of being a team that represents the Jewish community, it would seem that, I don't know. I think, Wiley doesn't really know who he has a problem with. I think he's just someone who tends to, like, I suppose, be like a dog with a bone. And once he kind of gets an idea, he kind of runs with it. So I think there was probably points in time which, if you'd asked Wiley to clarify, he'd have been able to make it very clear who he does have a problem with. But just because of the way he is, it just became, a bit crazy.
I think that, judging by the history of the tweets, Josh, let me ask you, do you think that there is an issue with individuals have an issue with the Jewish community? Do you think there's a, why do you think that is, Josh?
Well, I mean, look, first of all, I just want to say that there's no confusion for me and for the Jewish community, or for, I think, should be anybody. Those tweets that he sent out full of hate, and to sort of say even that there's any sort of justification in comparing Jews to the KKK. I mean, you know, in 2018, in America, in Pittsburgh, you had KKK white supremacists break into a synagogue and murder 11 Jews and six other people. I don't know how to get across how incredibly offensive that is. The only way, I guess, would be if you just put in everywhere he said black and Jewish, you put in black. Hopefully then you would sort of, if someone then said, oh, is there any justification comparing black people to the KKK? You'd be like, no, you're out of your mind. That's just proper racism. So there's no justification there. And also, it's not like it's one tweet. The guy just went off 48 hours of just proper Jew hate. You know, he's retweeting Holocaust denial. He's retweeting someone saying that Jews are the vilest people in the history of humanity. There's no sort of nuance there. This is just out and out racism. You know, calling Jewish people snakes, saying that... conspiracy theories about Jews having all the money. He's saying, like, Jews, you know, doing Instagram videos saying Jews crawl out of your little rocks. Saying he, on Instagram, he's sharing a conspiracy that Jews created the KKK. I mean, this isn't sort of just one little thing, or like he's had an argument. I could see where, you know, he's got an argument with this manager or whatever, but this is just, this comes from a place of hatred. And also, you know, misunderstanding, but just this is conspiracy theory madness. And it's not like he's kind of showing a genuine, any contrition or understanding of what he said and how that, you know, he asked for, he said Jewish people, they should hold some corn. Now I looked that up, that's slang to be shot. That's what he's saying. Jewish people need to be shot. And he said, and then he wrote straight away, and the Jewish community would deserve it. That's not, where's the ambiguity there? And then you got The Voice publishing an interview with him this week that even makes it worse, because then the writer sort of says what you guys were saying, that he's saying, you know, Wiley was saying that you need a Jewish lawyer to get ahead in the music industry, which is, again, it's just mad. It's just mad conspiracy theory lies. And then the writer's going, well, maybe this is a fallacy, but I've never seen anyone in the Jewish community refute or confirm this. Maybe it's a discussion that needs to be had. Again, if this was any other ethnicity, if that was reported and saying, well, you know, maybe they got a point, maybe we need to have a look at this, rather than just going, this is wrong, and we need to educate people why this is wrong. That should be the real, that should be what the lead in to this discussion is. Mm-hmm. And now I'll tell some jokes.
just want to clarify a few things what you said there, Josh, and thank you for sharing that with us and our viewers, because it's so important we could sit down here and discuss how right or how wrong things are, but again, I think it's great to hear it from yourself as you represent the whole of your community.
I am the king of the Jews.
Listen. I'm not going to dispute that, Jesus. Yes. But Dane, I can see that you've got. I can see you're itching with a question. Go on, my brother.
Oh no, it's not really a question yet. It's just following on what Josh said. Is that once you, it's important, and like I said, it's an interesting juxtaposition that if you hear articulated from the Jewish community, it does make a lot more sense, because yes, a lot of the time, normally you find it's ourselves and the diaspora trying to explain to people why certain microaggressions and certain things are offensive. But while some of us might be aware and think any discussion like this would be nuanced, and you'd be like, well, maybe while his commentary is about the record industry, but really, yeah, if it walks like a duck and talks like a duck, then it's a duck. And as you said, it's one thing where you may be talking about your own personal experience as a black person within an industry that is predominantly controlled by people that don't look like ourselves. But at the same time, if you are empowering, anti-Semitic rhetoric to the point whereby people are, saying Hitler was right, then in my normal experiences, if you're a black person saying something that people that support Hitler would agree with, then it must be wrong. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think
his tweets were being liked and retweeted by white supremacists. I mean, and when this week Quincy and I had a chat, and during what's going on with the Black Lives Matter movement, the rhetoric we're hearing, rightly so, is listen to us here, because of course I'm a white guy, I'm not going to know those, not just the microaggressions, the aggressions of what it's like to be black and dealing with the police and the thousands about and institutional racism and stuff. So there's all of that, and I and people have to listen to that experience to learn about it. And I guess the same here, but what Quincy said was great was like, how do you feel about it? And it's there's fear, there's because you've got to understand in the Jewish mentality, within living memory, 60 years ago, a third of us were wiped out, were just murdered. A third of us, and that's in living memory. That's our grandparents, our great uncles, our great, that's in living memory. So it's, and that isn't just like a one-off incident. That just follows multiple millennia of pogroms and murder and expulsions from countries and persecution. So when we start hearing this kind of dialogue, whoever it's coming from, where a white supremacist or Wiley or what, or we get scared. That's fear, because we have a fight, this flight response from learning. When you hear that stuff 60 years ago, we know where it led to, and then you hear it in today's age, it's scary, and you have it's to hurtful. And the Jewish community, and that's what we're good at, because contrary to belief, we don't control the world, we don't control the media or whatever. What we do, we control our voices, so we band together to be as loud as possible. And that's why you had Tracy Ann Oberman and Rachel Riley and whatever putting these tweets out there to create a movement to bring people's awareness to it, because that's the only thing that we could do. Because when you stay silent and it spreads, that's where we could see where that goes. And we could see where that's gone in America, where you've got in New York in December, you had three Jewish men killed in a supermarket by the Black Hebrews, which is just this like crazy conspiracy theory of the Jews somehow usurped Black people as the chosen people or whatever. But that sort of starts in Farrakhan and it ends up in people being killed. And if we don't call it out and examine it and look to and debunk it, it leads to real world violence. And as a Jew, when you see that stuff. It's scary. And when you're scared, you can either sort of run away and hide, or you can just shout as loud as you can.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, thanks for that, Josh.
There's another tweet.
I was going to ask Dane. I was supposed to ask you, Dane. Do you think that Wiley's tweet is more about articulation? Because what it is very important, if you're not articulate in a certain way, you can say something, it just seems like, hey, I love watching your comedy because you make me laugh. One of the things I always laugh, you can actually stand up. There's certain people that actually can call someone a pussyhole articulately, and it's not until they get home they realize, hang on a minute, did that comedian actually call me a pussyhole? Do you see what I mean? You can do things. Do you think that basically is Wiley just not articulate in his problems, in expressing his problems, or do you think he actually is just outright racist towards the Jewish community?
I wouldn't want to speak for Wiley, as I said before, but I think, unfortunately, there is enough about Wiley's aesthetic and narrative to suggest that he would be an inclusive person. And I think that might come from the fact that we always see it as kind of like an automatic thing that a black person would have a certain liberal platitudes towards, particularly the Jewish community, because there is a lot of intersectionality culturally and socially between, Judaism as a faith, as well as the journey of black people, so far as like there are a lot of parallels in terms of oppression, a lot of similarities in terms of custom and culture. And I think for a lot of black and Jewish people, what normally is normally the basis for our mutuality is this shared experience of oppression globally. I'm not sure if Wiley is aware of that, but I mean, myself personally, is like, you know, we have icons within our community, like, you know, Sammy Davis Jr. and, you know, mm-hmm. Lenny Kravitz, who, you know, both are of the Jewish faith, and that's never really had any bearing on their blackness. I mean, in a few instances, it was more like, for example, Sammy Davis Jr. being in support of Richard Nixon and more opting for whiteness rather than being of the Jewish faith. So I think because of that, it's seen that, I guess, as black people, we're trying to look for the narrative about oppression that Wiley is talking about and some level of inequality of representation in certain positions. But unfortunately, as Josh said, it's like this narrative, what it normally prefaces is actual violence. So I would say, you know, I haven't seen Wiley enact or encourage, up until this point, hadn't seen him previously encourage any hate speech or violence towards the Jewish community. But, you know, a bad tweet here and there, you could be like, he's just an idiot, or maybe this guy's on drugs. But a sustained, you know, narrative about the Jewish community, which begins to become extra industrial and outside of him talking about the music industry, to the point where, as I said, for me, if I'm talking to a point where white supremacists are retweeting me, that's when you have to kind of check yourself. So, I mean, so I just think, you know, this is, you know, somebody who, even though may not have this hatred or want to be encouraging hate speech, was uninformed, is uneducated, and was just massively irresponsible. So that's what I kind of say about Wiley. I think it's important that, like, for me, the main point of discussion amongst the diaspora, amongst the black community, has not been any kind, well, for me personally, not been any kind of solidarity with Wiley's statements. I think it's really been about the iniquity of response to his statements. Like, Wiley made what is regarded as hate speech, and as a response, rightfully so, he is being deprived of a platform where he can continue to encourage or empower hate speech or actions towards the Jewish community. What I guess seems to be the umbrage that a lot of black people are taking is not so much with the validity of what he's saying, it's that why other narratives that are anti-black do not receive the same level of reprimand.
Yeah, so, like Katie Hopkins, for example.
Katie Hopkins, yeah, or Tommy Morrison,
Tommy Robinson. The Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah. David Duke was only recently taken off. Like, you know, there's been instances where, like, members of the GOP and the Republican political base have actively encouraged or called for race wars, or even the Prime Minister himself referring to black people as pickaninnies. Anne-Marie Morris used reference harder than finding an N-word in a woodpile. So there's been all of these glaring, conspicuous examples of anti-blackness. Even this week, I had another Conservative MP blaming the BAME community, which...
Yeah.
Would you say that includes the Jewish community as minority?
Yeah.
So, you know, now we all of us again being reduced and put into the same pigeonhole outside of white Anglo-Saxon Protestant whiteness, and yeah, blaming us for this spike in COVID again. So yeah, myself personally, I don't. Whether Wiley is someone who actively practices anti-Semitism, it may not necessarily be likely because it's not been part of his narrative, but you know, he's done more than enough and made all of his Christmases or Hanukkahs come at once with his tweets. But I just think, he's massive damage. But I think the real issue is amongst Black people, maybe that's the point of discussion, is the fact that, you know, it took less than a week for him to rightfully be removed from social media platforms, where some people have been able to enjoy like disseminating the same kind of speech in the form of anti-Blackness for years without reprimand.
Yes. Good comparison.
They've, you know, at the end of the day, they've come together. They've done something about it. For some reason, we don't seem to have the same level of power for whatever reason. We can't get rid of the Kate Hopkins for whatever reason. We can't get rid of the Tommy Robinsons just like that. And they've put stuff out there that's been 100% categorically racist.
Can I just say something that's... First of all, the rate of Katie Hopkins being taken off was a massive part of Rachel Riley's campaign to do that. The Jewish community massively got behind that, support that, started that to make that a reality. You know, and I'm not saying that those other people, David Duke finally went off this week. And we know that for a long time, Twitter, Facebook, social media, they actively want this kind of dialogue. This hatred, because it makes them money.
Clickbait.
So it's clickbait. Not in their interest to cut this, to stop this kind of thing. But it just gets into a very dangerous area when you start trying to compare different ethnicity, different responses to different things. Because I don't think anybody that you've mentioned, and those examples all deserve absolutely to be reprimanded, have done what Wiley did, which is essentially a 48-hour, and it's still actually going on now with YouTube video stuff, of just out and out hate. None of them have said, shoot or kill all Black people. We need to go with
Josh,
all Black
Josh,
people.
Josh,
no one has said that.
Josh,
I'm going to pick up on that.
I hear what you're saying, Josh, 100%. Yeah. But this is one of the things that really frustrates the Black community, yeah? Okay. If somebody doesn't say something directly, outright, heinous, just like what Wiley said, it's kind of not seen as detrimental to our community. So you're saying
I can absolutely relate to that. There are thousands of anti-Semites who make constant, like you say, microaggressions, constantly spread anti-Semitic rumors or innuendo. Mate, I get that. That's my life. That's my Twitter timeline. It's just full of that. Yes. I'm talking about out and out, let's murder those people. That's different. Yeah. That's what's different. And by the way, that didn't come off straight away. He's doing that for like 12 hours, and all he got initially was a suspension for 12 hours. Then it became a week, and it was only when the Jewish community could mobilize to make enough noise about this that finally they stepped in to give him a ban. Now, there could be different reasons that let's not buy into the stereotype that means that Jews are more powerful or more connected or whatever. Yeah. Jews are the tiniest part, such a small part of what we're 0.2% of the world population. What we have, though, is our voices. We're quite an homogenous community as well. So we have, you know, one very clear organization that represents British Jewry. And also, we've been fighting anti-Semitism for the last few years now, coming from the Labour Party, coming from the right. So this is, everything was there set up to address this, you know. And I just want to say one more thing. What Dave was saying is, in terms of also being part of the BAME community, is Jews, this is just an educational thing, but Jews are an ethno-religion. Because the religion goes down through our mother, what it means is, you know, you look at the genetics of Jews, they go back to the Middle East. And also, if you go to Israel, 60% of the Jewish population there are Black or brown. So I know we like to think that all Jews look like me, but get me out in Israel and I will start looking Spanish, and then it will get, you know, I become looking Arabic. Mm-hmm. And but if you go out there, there's a huge portion of the Jewish population, and certainly in Israel, the majority who are black or brown. And I, if you took my DNA, it would go back to the Middle East as well. So I don't put white when I'm on the census or anything. I put other.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point as well, Josh, is that I guess what I would want to know in that respect is that, is there, so far as somewhere like Israel, then is there a, do you have the same kind of racial stratification then? Because as you said, and those are aware.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I'm not going to lie. There have been issues in Israel with racism where there was this kind of the Ashkenazi, which are what the sort of European Jews initially when Israel was started would be the majority of the, you know, the judges and the politicians and whatever. That has changed over the years as well. I'm going to not deny there are issues over there. There is a sort of stratification that has been dealt with. Certainly it was more historical and it's changing now. But as in Jewish culture, you know, belief in God, these are all secondary to your status as a Jew. And even last week, a plane load of Ethiopian Jews were rescued from Ethiopia, from the civil war over there, and brought to Israel. There are Chinese Jews, Indian Jews, every across the entire sort of spectrum. The only really important thing is how annoying is your mother? That defines Jewish experience. And I'm sure
that cuts across all communities.
I think a large part of this conversation is. I see myself as a black person, and as I said, mentioned before, that there is an affinity with the Jewish community in terms of how we've rationalized and thrived in spite of oppression, especially more contemporary examples of oppression with, like, you know, the Holocaust, and obviously with civil rights, and Jewish members of the Jewish community being actively involved in certain civil rights, like, you know, with actual people dying, like in.
Absolutely, I think it was 99% of the lawyers in the civil rights struggle in America were Jewish and unpaid. If you look at a film like Mississippi Burning about a real life incident, Jewish guys going down to do voter registration down in the South, they were killed. With.
And even the fact that a lot of times the Black Lives Matter movement is likened to a Marxist organization, which I think there is a kind of quasi anti-Semitic narrative when people are saying it's Marxist, and referring to socialism, because obviously these ideologies having their origins from Jewish people as well. But my question is, are there active discussions within the Jewish community that would be based maybe in the UK
with regards in terms of participating within
black self-determination, and you know, when the Jewish community sees something like Black Lives Matter, is there like a united kind of front?
Yes. All of the Jewish organizations, which the main one being the British Board of Jewish Deputies, you've got CST, which is like the community defense, like who fight anti-Semitism, whatever. Everybody has been in support of the Black Lives Matter movement. You have a massive undertaking at the moment. There's a big, it's more than discussion. It's a study that's sort of been led into Black British Jews, the Black British Jewish experience. And Jews, because it's part of our morality, fairness, equality. And you've got to remember, I know it's many thousands of years ago, but Jews were slaves in Egypt. But that is something that's repeated to us in all of our festivals, something that we constantly is part of our sort of daily reality in terms of through our rituals and stuff at that time. If there's anything else in terms of what these feelings have brought up within myself and the Jewish community is sort of a feeling of hurt, because Jews do look back to the Black community as natural allies, and see ourselves as being allies of the Black community. So when a member, and of course Wiley is one person within that, just like I wouldn't expect anybody to blame one Jewish person if they came out with horrific stuff as being representable Jews. But I guess then it's like, what then Jewish community would look to be would just be not trying to explain it, not trying to whatever, but more just like, let's condemn this and let's discuss, have an open discussion about why he might feel like that. Why, where is he getting these ideas from? And I know where they're from. They're from Farrakhan. They're from these ridiculous conspiracies that he, books that he wrote about Jews controlling the slave trade that have been utterly debunked. And why are people buying into this narrative? That's what needs to be looked at.
Well, yeah, because I think that's one of the reasons why, and I think it's how someone like Wiley is able to co-opt this anti-Semitism and have what appears to be a lot of support from a lot of black peers, is that I think that is a big part of the narrative I've seen from my generation, is we have historically seen these allegiances between the black and Jewish community. But obviously there is some nuance to that, in that, as you said, you know, maybe on a tribal level, some parts of the Jewish community, whether Ashkenazi or have their origins in Europe, can co-opt for whiteness mm-hmm. when it suits them. And I think sometimes that's a perception mm-hmm. that black people get, is that while we think it's supposed to be an automatic alliance between ourselves and Jews, and for fairness, it seems in certain issues that where we feel we deal with certain elements of nuanced oppression, maybe it's like, you know, with the issue of like the dreadlock ban in schools or in offices, or, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. being held to account for our music, and only the people in front of the microphone and the artists themselves being held accountable. And, mm-hmm. you know, despite the fact that, you know, there are Jewish members of the music industry who have very positively worked jointly with black people to promote success. Like, you know, you see someone like Salam Remy and Amy Winehouse. And so I guess the question is there active discussion within the Jewish community where they are equally appalled by the oppression and marginalization that black people deal with in this country? And are we having regular discussions enough where, you know, potentially there may be a way, like you said, of, you know, educating black people now to galvanize our voices to assert our rights or our equality yeah. that we're not getting from the Jewish community. And yeah, that, I mean, definitely. And that can't possibly be the Jewish community as a whole, because obviously, as you said, there's intersectionality where you have Mithrazi Jews who are who have African origins, and Sephardic Jews are based in the Middle East. But, and not that I'm trying to make it an individual thing per tribe, but do you think there's an issue where, you know, members of the Jewish community can co-opt for whiteness that kind of affects that that support? Because I think as I'm trying to say, yeah, is that
I mean look, I'm white passing or whatever, but yes, are there steps that the Jewish community can take to support those things? But I like I said, they are happening. Those talks are literally going on right now. Mm-hmm. But I just would like to say that there's two things there. First of all, this whole Jews are 0.2% of the population, yeah. you know, in the world yeah. population. Wiley had double the amount of followers on Twitter than there are Jews in the UK. He's got 500,000 followers. There are 250,000. There's only so much we could do. I mean, there's these microaggressions, these whatever. This is like, it's not, I'm not saying that no Jew is perfect, but there's that we don't control the world. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's not like we can do anything. We are just trying to survive ourselves, and we will do what we can to reach out, I imagine, as a community. And like I say, these things are ongoing, but let's not buy into a weird way of a sort of the stereotype that Jews can do anything. We don't control the world. Yeah. There are very few of us. Mm-hmm. We are just literally trying to live our lives and survive ourselves. So of course, I personally am very, imbued in the Black Lives Matter movement, less so the organization and the things that need to be done in our wider society. But we don't, there's someone I know I could speak to who's going to make this stuff go away. We're just tiniest part of what is the larger society that is actually carrying out all of this stuff, you know. And
Do you think that could be encouraged? Because I think, yeah, you make a very good point. It's like you said, we are a minority, and there's only so much we can do. Given, obviously, like, you know, where we get the similar grouping under this weird BAME umbrella, do you think that a big part, I mean, and I can only speak for my community, where, as you said yourselves, we are aware of how oppression works, and it's not going to be our go-to to marginalize another group. Do you think... moving forward, and even when it's a suggestion, like I said myself, where I may have erroneously suggested that, like, well, you know, black people are very happy to defend everybody where we see any facet of oppression, do you think that there's probably more required for people to understand the state of the Jewish community within Western Europe and the UK as a whole, And is and have you seen any paradigms that would help that dialogue? Because what I'm saying is that I may have thought there may be more Jews and maybe more Jews in the UK and maybe more numbers than I suspected. But obviously, you're making it very clear that you are a minority. And by that same token, should there be more opportunities for outreach so we can at least educate, you know, within this paradigm, Afro-Jewish discourse?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Like I said, the large, I've been reading about the steps that the outreach between both communities, and even doing something like this is important for it. I mean, all I can speak is to, I'm just an ordinary Jewish man trying to live his life and trying to raise five children and do homeschooling. But when my kids were actually in school, back in the day, 5 months ago, you know, Black History Month was a massive part of their history. They come home, we'd work on projects together about when they learned about Windrush in school. They learned about slavery. They learned about Rosa Parks, Nelson Mandela. So that education is coming. And also in our synagogues, these things are talked about because they unfairness and injustice of any kind is something to be examined and confronted and fought against. And that goes to the core of the Jewish experience.
Beautiful, man.
And I'm sure for any ethnicity and any people, it's always going to, and even today there's a good step that's been taken. 700 musicians and people have come out and spoken about, out about and coming together, and it's always going to be through education. It's always going to be just through dialogue and talking, and just, I think the problem that, and why anti-Semitism can be so pernicious is because for lots of reasons, but one is there's very few of us. So there's very few of us to actually defend or to come on a show like this and to actually talk about it and to say this is the actual reality, and it's not a bunch of people all running the world and whatever. It's a bunch of people just trying to survive. And
I say something, Josh? Do you know what? Sure. Do you know what's the beautiful thing about what's going on now? There's six of us in this room right now, in this studio, and we're all comics. We all come down to it, do a dick joke or frigging some kind of material, and we have made more dialogue and more sense in the space of a short period of time than our so-called scholars and leaders. And I think what is happening now is the dialogue is trying to understand both sides of the story. Is that our so-called leaders need to take heed of what is happening here right now. And we're just ordinary cats, as you say, trying to, I sound like a guy from the 70s, we're ordinary cats, man.
Quincy, you make a good point, because I think that's, I mean, comedy was probably one of the industries which allowed for both the Jewish and the Black community to have a discourse about our shared experiences, because you know, you would have, like, you'd have had, like, you know, Lenny Bruce and, you know, him dealing Richard with obscenity, Richard Pryor working with Gene Wilder, and I think, you know, I'm sure Josh, you probably know better than myself that, like with Black people, artistic expression has always been one of the ways we rationalized our oppression. The finer points of Jewish comedy would have crystallized while people were in concentration camps and trying to make sense of their situation, in the same way that comedy for Black people was always served the same way, is that, like, a lot of the basis for our comedy is taking elements of our culture, which is normally ridiculed by dominant culture, and reclaiming that and making it powerful for ourselves. Like, you know, on the one hand, for example, you know, Black people were always supposed to be parentally irresponsible with our kids and stuff, but we can take that kind of baby mother and baby father comedy and make that very funny, and again make people feel very empowered, and instead of kind of being demoralized. So that is probably a real important point that kind of Quincy's brought up, is that what we're able to do in comedy, is there any way whereby which that can happen in terms of real life conversation as well? Because genuinely, I guess it's like sorry, go on, Quincy.
And I'm going to tell our producers and directors this same conversation, send it to Boris and open up the comedy clubs, because this is what it needs. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because we are the last.
I'm a bit going today, because I was coming on here thinking
the Jews are in control. I thought Josh was going to get everybody our reparations and everything was going to be amazing. That's what we got you on here for, Josh. I want my money, son.
I'm sorry.
I heard you was a liar.
I got to go higher up. I'm just the base person. I got to go higher up.
I'm out. But I just want to play devil's advocate here, Josh. And because what it is, we've got to have some a serious little discussion on the other side. I think what it is for sometimes for people in the black community, and I'm not speaking for the whole community, but I think what it is that, you know, you gave us some real good numbers as regards to the percentage of the Jewish population in the UK and a percentage globally as well. But I think, you know, because the history that we learn in schools is taught to us by a certain section of society. And we already see that's why we need to have black history in schools. I think probably we need to have something like Jewish history properly in schools. Because the only thing what we know about Jewish history is the Holocaust. And that's what's taught. So again, it's from a very negative point of view. So I think discussions like this are great. But the reasons why I think, you know, you've got people like Wiley thinking what he's thinking and other, you know, small segments of society, especially within the black communities, is when they think to, when they think about like Israel, for example, the fact that, you know, the narrative's fed is like, oh, there was this country called Palestine. Then all of a sudden the Europeans got together and said to the Jewish community, here you are, here's a piece of land for you and you can call it Israel. Ooh. So they think, well, hold on. You must have power forever for doing something like that, because you know what? If the black people said, "Hear what now? We want the whole of South America," that would never happen. So you, but these discussions are really, really necessary, and I think we need to have more.
Absolutely. I mean, just to say Israel, I always hate bringing Israel into it because it's such a complicated thing. But first of all, there's a continent called Africa.
Yes.
You know, Jews have no. This is our ancestral home. This is where we come from. The idea that the self-realization of us, it's not like there's lots of Jewish countries or whatever. This was it. This is where we proven historically have come from. And I'm sorry to get all bogged down in history and stuff, but there was never an actual country called Palestine. There was something called the British Mandate of Palestine, which was taken from, before then it was a province part of the Turkish Empire. Now that's not to justify what happened with the Palestinian people, and it's a very complicated thing. But this is the problem now. Israel suddenly becomes the big baddie for everything. Now, if you look at the history of anti-Semitism, you know, 2,000 years ago, it would be that Jews killed Jesus. You know, then it became, so then it was about the religion, and then it became, and Jews murdered Christian children for blood. Then it became in Hitler's Germany, it became that Jews were unclean, we were an inferior race of people, and now it's moved to Israel, and that's where the anti-Semitism morphs until and changes form to fit the day. But in terms of there was something I did want to say is in terms of this Wiley and music industry or whatever, people you know, you guys know about obviously about cognitive bias, but it works both ways. So if someone sees that there's a Jewish lawyer, then cognitive bias, if you've been fed your life conspiracy theories of Jews running the world or whatever, you then go, oh, well, there's a Jewish lawyer, thus all lawyers are Jewish. And that works towards whatever ethnicity and whatever horrible stereotype. You see someone, you go, oh, well, that person's black or that person's Indian, thus that proves your theories about... That is racism. That's racism in people's hearts that we all... a part of where all of humanity, it has those racist assumptions within us, and they come out with cognitive bias. Now, I am Jewish. I know probably 1,000 Jewish people, and of them, I think there's about 5 or 10 lawyers, and there's about maybe there's about 3 people I know work in a bank. The most Jews I know are middle class teachers, estate agents, comedians, obviously some comedians, people work, you know, so I represent just like in black culture, there are going to be black entertainers and black millionaires and black lawyers or whatever. But the racism that we bring from our heart, from that racism we've been learned, you look at a, you don't look at a black lawyer and go, well, there's proof. All lawyers are black. You know what I mean?
I think there's a big part of it is race. I think a big part of it is race baiting. And just continuing from C's point in terms of, a lot of our education regarding the Jewish community is, it's very much the as far back as some biblical references, and you know the Book of Exodus, and kind of ends there. Or we go forward to like post war, and then you know the in terms of like Israel. I think it's a technique that's used a lot of the time is that there, even though we do, there is similarities between, like I said, in terms of narrative for the Jewish and Black community journey, what you tend to find is, to put it bluntly, people kind of like, well, the Jews are okay after they were oppressed. What's wrong with you Black people? Why can't you blah, 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 blah? So it's almost as if we're kind of set against each other.
Yeah.
And there's this false equivalency that tends to cause the issue. So
yeah, and that's what they want. That's what they want. Of course, that's what they want.
Who's day? You mean the white man?
I absolutely mean the white man. I mean the people in the world. I mean, if you look, you know, these Jews run the banks. Jews don't own the banks and the whatever. Yeah, you've got some Jewish millionaires and Black billionaires. You've got Black billionaires. But if you look where the real money is in the world, it's China. It's Russia. Oligarch. These are the people who really have all the money and have this. I'm not trying to say this as a, you know, it's Saudi Arabians. Not I'm trying to in any way say anything about Muslims or whatever. I'm just saying that's where the money in our world is, and that's the system that they want to propagate and keep going, because that money keeps on serving itself.
Yeah, it helps them. Yeah, of course.
Well, listen, guys, we could talk about this all day long. I think we need to do a part two, 100%. But what we want to say, you know what? Josh, especially, we want to say thank you. And also, we want to send a big thank you out to the Jewish community for allowing you on our show. Because I know that you had to speak to enough elders before you came on here.
It was a nightmare.
Your wife.
Listen, I know the Epsteins and the Coopers very well, man. Send my love to them as well. Dane, we want to say thank you. And listen, Dane, you are the only guest who's ever come on this show with a microphone. You're a true professional comedian. he even goes to the supermarket with his microphone, you know.
Exactly. Well, see, that's because my elders are in the room, and it's like, so I have to
show up. Have any planting? No, but listen, well, honestly, guys, we thank you both so much for coming on the show. Josh and Dane, ladies and gentlemen. Well, listen. Oh man, thank you so much. So, listen, it's time to wrap up the show, guys. Man, what a week! Oh my days. You know what? I love the fact that the show just keeps on growing every single week, and I've got to say, it wouldn't be the same without you guys, man. So, to wrap things up, Slim, what's happening for you this week, sir?
This week I've got some new gadgets that I'm trying to learn. I've got a new laptop here, and it's like a spaceship. New technology, man. It's new technology. So I've got some bits I'm doing there. I've got an announcement also on the 17th. So I'm just really just building up to that big announcement there.
There you go. So 17th of August, you've heard it exclusively here at Hashtag Comedy TV. Slim is going to be making a big announcement. Make sure you're following him at Slim Comedian to be the first to find out what that announcement's going to be. Kane, what's happening on the gram this week with you, sir?
Nothing, brother. Well, you know what? It's my birthday coming up tomorrow.
Come on, bro. So,
tomorrow? I'm just going to be... Wow! So now I'm catching up with you, man. Glasses.
Oh, you mean? Let me tell you, just all it is, you've got to take time and choose the right frame for you. That's it, man.
But so I've got my Instagram live on Wednesday, which is always good. I haven't chosen the topics yet. So if you guys can make some suggestions, send it to me, Kane_Brown_comedy on Instagram. And yeah. Tell me what you guys would like to suggest.
Excellent. And Quincy, last but no means least, big man, tell us about your radio show this week, please.
Yeah, so this week I'm actually talking to a few guests from the female persuasion. I'm trying to get into the mindset of what it is like for women to be oppressed, so to speak, and it's more of a case for change. For more of a case for me to shut my mouth and listen and learn, as we did today. You see what I did there?
Yeah. Smart.
but a woman wouldn't have done that at the end, Quincy. She would have just left it there. She would have just left it there. It just leaves me to say goodbye, and I want to say thank you for everybody for tuning in. Don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and remember, we're nothing without your support. See you next week, same time, same place, #ComedyTV.